Anybody ever want to hide? I do. Want to hide and get away and... Amen. Amen. And Jesus is a hiding place.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Technology.
Amen.
You see us set up with cameras and phones, and we take advantage of all the free media out there. We
Amen.
Record, we post it to YouTube, we put it on our website, we post it to Facebook from YouTube, and we use Periscope and broadcast live the message.
Amen.
So we take advantage, you know, we may be small, but God has given us grace and ability, technology, technological ability to do things. So we praise God for that.
Thank you all.
So that's why we have the phone and everything set up. We're trying to get phone calls. Amen. Amen. So we come this morning, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you, Lord, for just another opportunity to get into your word, to do those things that you have called us to do. And now, Father, I pray that you would anoint me, touch my lips, touch my heart, touch the hearts of those that will be receiving this message, Lord, that they may receive it and then do the things that you have called us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. When tragedy strikes, the first words we sometimes hear are, "Where was God? How could he allow this to happen?" People want an explanation or reason for the senseless act. Some even go so far as to demand an answer from God, the creator of the whole universe, the maker and sustainer of life. Demand an answer of God. Can you imagine? Perhaps it may have even been you that's done this. God made us with reason and logic, and we use that reason and logic to try to figure things out. But what happens when there seems to be no reason or logic for what happens? What happens when our brains just won't wrap around an event? Just a couple of days ago, an airman at Lackland Air Force Base in San Antonio, Texas, walked in his commander's office and shot him and then himself.
Wow.
Right now, no one knows why. When 9/11 happened, there were many people asking the question, how could God allow this to happen? Where was God during all of this? Why didn't he save all those people? The nation quickly found religion. Prayer started happening in some unusual places, and no one dared complain. High-rise buildings were aglow with crosses and lights, and no one dared complain. Churches were filled to capacity with people looking for answers, and no one dared to complain. Religion was okay because we had nowhere else to turn for answers, trying to make sense of a senseless act. After 9/11, a woman named Stacy Randall wrote a poem entitled, "Meet Me in the Stairwell." And it goes like this. You say you will never forget where you were when you heard the news on September 11, 2001. Neither will I. I was on the 110th floor in a smoke-filled room with a man who called his wife to say goodbye. I held his finger steady as he dialed. I gave him the peace to say, "Honey, I'm not going to make it, but it is okay. I am ready to go." I was with his wife when he called as she fed breakfast to their children. I held her up as she tried to understand his words and as she realized he wasn't coming home that night. I was in the stairwell on the 23rd floor when a woman cried out to me for help. "I have been knocking on the door of your heart for 50 years, I said. "Of course I will show you the way home. Only believe in me now." I was at the base of the building with a priest ministering to the injured and devastated souls. I took him home to tend to his flock in heaven. He heard my voice and answered. I was on all four of those planes in every seat with every prayer. I was with the crew as they were overtaken. I was in the very hearts of the believers there, comforting and assuring them that their faith has saved them. I was in Texas, Virginia, California, Michigan, Afghanistan. I was standing next to you when you heard the terrible news. Did you sense me? I want you to know that I saw every face. Mm. I knew every name, though not all knew me. Some met me for the first time on the 86th floor. Some sought me with their last breath. Some couldn't hear me calling to them through the smoke and flames. Come to me, this way, take my hand. Some chose for the final time to ignore me, but I was there. I did not place you in that tower that day. You may not know why, but I do. However, if you were there in that explosive moment in time, would you have reached for me? September 11, 2001 was not the end of the journey for you, but someday your journey will end and I will be there for you as well. Seek me now while I may be found. Then, at any moment, you know you are ready to go.
Amen.
I will be in the stairwell of your final moments. Jesus.
Amen.
We often ask the question, God, where were you? And he wants me to tell you today, I'm still here.
Still here.
And that is our message title today. I'm still here.
Still here.
Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 31. I'll be reading from the New International Version. And it's one verse of scripture. We're going to go to Deuteronomy 31, verse 8. When you have it, you can say amen.
Amen.
Deuteronomy 31. Amen.
Amen.
All right. And it reads as thus, the Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. The word of the Lord is already blessed.
Amen.
I'm still here.
Still here.
When this chapter begins, Moses is telling the Israelites he will not be going into the promised land with them. He is 120 years old and it's time for him to go. Turn me down just a little bit. Before this, he let his anger and people make him miss out on his blessing. Don't let people make you miss out on your blessing. God told Moses to speak to the rock, and he got upset with the people and called them names and then slapped the rock. He still got what he was supposed to get, but not the way he was supposed to get it. It's important how you do things. You can't just do them any old kind of way. When God gives us an assignment, there's a way to do things. Amen? It's important to pay attention. So he has been their leader for the last 40 years, and now they're at the end of this leg of the journey. They can look over and see what God has told them was theirs. They can see the promised land. But the people were afraid. Moses had been leading them, praying for them. They had seen miracles like the parting of the Red Sea, all with Moses as their leader, and now Joshua was about to take over. The place they were going to was new. It was different. Many of the spies had come back and brought back negative reports. The fruits and vegetables were huge, but so were the people living there. But despite all of that, God had promised them the land, the land flowing with milk and honey, and it was time to go get their blessing.
Amen.
Joshua was one of the two spies who came back with a good report that God had promised them the land and they should go and take it. So as we get to verse 7, Moses turns his encouragement to Joshua. How many need just a little encouragement sometimes?
Amen.
Not a long psychoanalysis of the situation, not 15 steps to a better life, not what you should have, would have, could have done, just some encouragement that says, you got this. Go for it. Mm-hmm. Failure is not an option.
All right.
Now, here's the good news. Moses tells him, the Lord himself goes before you. If you knew that the Lord himself, not a stand-in, not a substitute, not a proxy or his assistant, but the Lord himself was going before you into a situation, wouldn't you go boldly into whatever it was?
Amen.
I would. So how does that happen?
Well, first you pray.
All right.
Talk to God. Ask him what he wants you to do, where he wants you to go, and when. You have to follow God's plan for your life. Join him in what he's doing. Don't make your plan and ask him to join you. You see, God is the boss of you.
Mm-hmm.
He has formulated a plan for your life, and it's perfect.
Amen.
It's not without some bumps, bruises, mountains, and valleys, but still, it's the perfect plan for your life. And when you're following the plan God has laid out for your life, then the Lord Himself will go before you. And guess what? Mm-hmm. When you get those bumps and bruises, and when you come to those mountains and valleys, He will patch you up, mm-hmm. pick you up, and carry you through to the other side.
All right.
Now, He doesn't just go before you. It said the Lord Himself goes before you and will be with you. Mm-hmm. You see, when they got to the promised land, there were some giants they were going to have to deal with, but God was going to be with them. He's not just going to take you and drop you off. He's going to stay with you. How many know that just because you got to your destination, it doesn't mean that you're good to go?
All right.
And to be more clear, until we die, we are on a journey. Our life is a journey, and we don't arrive until we die and see Jesus face to face. So you can't stop. When you complete one task, God has another for you.
Amen.
Think about it. With school, you have to complete all the requirements for the grade you're in before you go to the next grade.
Amen.
Then you get to be a senior in high school. You graduate. Then you can go to college. In college, you complete sometimes an associate's degree. Then you can get your bachelor's degree. Then you move on to your master's degree. Then if you want, you can go on to complete your doctorate or your PhD. Sometimes you just need someone to say, you can do it.
Amen.
Take one day at a time.
Amen.
Every step you take in life is leading you somewhere. Wouldn't it be better to take the path you know God has laid out for you? You can save yourself a lot of time, heartache, disappointment, trouble, and even money. There was a sister that testified that she went to college, and she went to college and went to study and what she wanted to study, and she got to the end of it and graduated, and the Lord told her, well, that's not what I told you to do. And so she had to go back to school, get her degree in psychiatry, which is what the Lord was calling her to, and now she has a very successful, not only practice in psychiatry, but a very successful ministry. Amen. Has anybody ever heard of Carolyn Shobell?
Amen.
Amen. She's from Baltimore. That was her. Amen. So, but she wasted time and money going to school for something God had not called her to do. But in the end, she got it right, and He blessed her.
Amen.
You see, when you're going to be obedient to God, you have to ask Him what He wants you to do. You have to listen to what He says, and most importantly, you have to do what He says.
Amen.
When you love God, you want to please Him. How many like it when your parents or your spouse or someone like a teacher or someone in authority praises you and tells you you did a good job? Amen? That's a love language, affirmation. Some people just, they'll just do anything for you. Give them some praise. Amen? Well, that's how it is when you love God. You try to do things to please Him.
Amen.
I directed the choir at one of the churches that we attended, and we were getting ready for a big concert. And I remember praying before the concert, I just want to make God smile. And He blessed the choir, He blessed me, He blessed our musician, and most of all, I think He was pleased and He smiled.
Amen.
And I was so happy at the end of that concert. Amen?
Amen?
But not only does the Lord Himself go before you, not only will He be with you, He will never leave you nor forsake you.
That's right.
That excites me.
Amen.
He will never leave me.
That's the word.
Never is a long time. That's forever. Husbands leave, wives leave. Sometimes it's through a divorce, sometimes it's death, sometimes it's abandonment. Children leave. They're supposed to. They're supposed to go to college. They're supposed to go out on their own. But sometimes they die too. Parents leave. Sometimes it's abandonment. Sometimes it's death. Sometimes they just move to another place. But God.
Okay.
God will never leave you. And I'm so glad that God will never leave me. How about you?
Amen.
Anybody glad about it? He said, I'm still here. Those other folks may let you down. They may walk away. They may just move away. But God.
But God.
He's not going anywhere.
All right.
Now, you may walk away from Him, but He's not leaving you. So if you find yourself in a desert place and you can't hear God, try going back to the last place you heard Him. Perhaps you've gotten off course because God is saying, I'm still here. Turning around is okay. People think it's failure to go back to the beginning, but if you know you're going in the wrong direction, why would you keep going that way? Stop. Somewhere you need to turn around and go another direction, and the sooner the better, because the longer you go in the wrong direction, the further you'll be from where God wants you to go. The further you'll be from the plan God has for your life.
All right.
Here's your choice. Keep going in the wrong direction, or turn right and go straight.
All right, now.
What will you do? So not only will God never leave you, not only will he will never forsake you. I looked up for some other words for this word forsake and found abandon, desert, leave. We're talking about God never forsaking us. Some other words for forsake were disown. You are his workmanship and he will not be ashamed of you. He will never deny you. He will always claim you as his own. Quit. In the old days when a man and woman broke up, they would say he or she quit you. God won't do that. Ditch. Reject. Anybody ever been rejected? Doesn't feel good, does it? Well, God will never reject you. Cast off. When you cast something off, you throw it away. Renounce is what all of these words mean. Relinquish. God will not relinquish you to be devoured by the enemy. He's got you in his hands. He won't let you fall, and he'll never let you go. Turn your back on him. God won't turn his back on you and act like he doesn't know you. You are his child, and he loves you. He won't give up. Don't give up on God, because he won't give up on you. And sacrifice. God will not sacrifice you for anything, and he'll never ask you to sacrifice anything. You see, when you choose to allow Jesus to be Lord and Savior of your life, you're not giving up anything. It's all gain for you.
Amen.
God owns everything, so how can we be giving up anything? When you give your life to Christ, you become a joint heir to the kingdom of God, and he has more than enough.
That's right.
God is a God of abundance. He's a God of excess who has given you unlimited access.
All right,
he's a God who wants to bless you beyond all you could ask or think, according to the power that works in you. There was a sacrifice, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus was the last, the only, and the perfect sacrifice for our sins. When he came in the form of man, he was our perfect example. He showed us how to live a sinless life, and we can, with the help of the Holy Spirit. The Comforter he left for us to dwell in us so that we can hear God speak, so we can hear what thus saith the Lord, and so we can follow the plan God has for our lives. You want to know what plan God has for your life? Pray and ask him. He'll tell you, and you can believe it's a good plan.
Amen.
In fact, it's a great plan.
Amen.
So since the Lord himself is going before you, since he will be with you, since he will never leave you, and since he will never forsake you, Moses said, don't be afraid and don't be discouraged.
All right.
Fear has a strange effect on people. Sometimes fear will stop you in your tracks. It will paralyze you. Sometimes fear will make you run like if a dog comes after you.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes fear will confuse you and you won't know which way to go. But most of all, fear will keep you from reaching your God-given potential. But fear is not of God.
All right, say that.
2 Timothy 1:7 tells us, for God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, but of power and of love and of a sound mind.
Mm-hmm.
So if fear is not from God, who's it from?
Mm-hmm.
Satan, of course.
That's right.
The enemy, the devourer, the one who seeks to kill, steal, and destroy.
Come on.
But God gave you power.
Yes.
Power to overcome. Power to defeat. Power to rise up. Power to win, power to cast down,
yeah.
Power to stand in the face of whatever they come against you. Then he gave you love, and with that love you can deal with whoever comes against you for whatever reason they come. Love covers all sin.
Uh-huh.
If someone does you wrong, love the devil out of them. You've heard the expression, you get more flies with honey. Well, the word of God says it this way, a soft answer turns away wrath.
Yeah.
Someone comes at you fired up, speak to them with the love of the Lord. A sincere, God bless you. Will send them back every time, then walk away.
Amen.
Then he gave you a sound mind. In the New International Version, in the New Living Translation, that word is translated self-discipline. That means you control your emotions, your reactions, and your words. God has given you the ability to hold your tongue when you want to let it rip. Believe it or not, it's there. When that person has gotten on what you thought was your last nerve, you find out God has given you one more.
One more nerve.
Amen. When you think, if that person says one more foul thing to me, God has given you the ability to listen and not hit them.
Yes, Lord.
God has given you the self-discipline to study His word and not leave it for later. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. He's given you the self-discipline to pray daily, not just when you want something from God like He's a short order cook. He's given you the self-discipline to stand when everything else seems to be falling around you. After you've done all you can, you just stand. God has given you a lot of things, but fear is not one of them. Amen? So when fear starts to creep in, just know that it's the enemy trying to keep you from your destiny. But greater is He who is in me, that would be the Holy Spirit, than he who is in the world, that would be Satan. The Holy Spirit lives in us. He dwells in us. God is all around us, and He wants me to tell you, I'm still here.
Still here.
And finally, the scripture says, don't get discouraged. Fear and discouragement run together. They are old friends. You see, when you're afraid to do something and you let that fear stop you, then you get discouraged because you didn't do it. And oh my goodness, don't let someone come behind you and do it. You really get discouraged then. Then you begin to doubt yourself the next time God gives you an assignment because you're looking at people instead of looking at God.
All right.
But can I tell you something? God does not want you to do that thing like someone else. He made you an original, and He wants you to do what you do the way you do it, because guess what? He's the one that gave you your gift, and nobody can do the thing that He gave you like you can. So stop looking around and do what you do the way you do it. No matter how well you think someone else might do it. As we look around us, sometimes the situation looks desperate, but God said, despite what the world looks like, I'm still here.
Still here.
Despite what you hear and see on television, God said, I'm still here.
Still.
Despite what you see and hear in the movie theater, God said, I'm still here.
Uh-huh.
Despite the tornadoes and hurricanes and tsunamis and earthquakes and mudslides and storms and fires and falling trees, God said, I'm still here.
Still.
Despite the car accidents and drunk drivers, God said, I'm still here. Despite cancer and strokes and heart attacks and heart disease and Alzheimer's disease and dementia and birth defects and limbs being blown off in war, God said, I'm still here.
Still.
Despite your failures, your disappointments, and your failed relationships, God said, I'm still here.
Yeah.
It truly does not matter what's happening all around us. God said, I'm still here.
Yeah.
He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to reconcile us to Him, to build a bridge so we can cross that great divide that's between heaven and hell. But you can't cross unless you receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior.
Uh-huh.
You see, it's that belief that gives you access to the bridge.
Yeah.
It's that belief that gives you access to the riches of heaven.
Yeah.
It's that belief that gives you access to the blessings of God.
Uh-huh.
It's that belief that allows you to go to heaven.
Yeah.
To get your mansion that Jesus has prepared for you. He said it in John 14, verses 2 and 3. In my Father's house are many mansions.
Yeah.
If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. That's what Jesus said.
Yeah.
Do you want your mansion?
Mm-hmm.
You think these houses here or something? You ain't seen nothing yet.
Come on now.
Just wait until you get to heaven. The streets are paved with gold.
Yeah.
Jesus is, and God are the light of the city, so there is no need for a sun. You can read all about that in Revelation. We read a little bit about it in our responsive reading. But here's the thing. There's only one way to see any of this.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
That's right.
Jesus is the door.
Yes.
And if you want to see heaven, you must come in at the door. Romans 10, 9 and 10 in the New International Version says it this way. If you declare with your mouth, that means say it out loud, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved.
Be saved.
It's that simple.
Amen.
Not hard. No doubt. Not maybe, not could be, not should, would, could, but you will be saved.
Amen.
But why is that? Well, verse 10 is the answer. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Just that simple. You don't have to turn cartwheels or run around the building three times or make a speech or write an essay. All you have to do is come down this aisle right now and give your heart. Make the Lord, make Jesus the Lord of your life. God says, I'm still here.
Still.
But not only that, God says, I love you, and I'm waiting for you.
Yeah.
I sent my son to die for you. Now, won't you give your life for him?
Amen.
The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Even now, God has gone before you. He won't leave you nor forsake you. So don't be afraid to come now, and don't be discouraged about the times you didn't come before. That may not have been your time, but God has given you another opportunity, and perhaps today is your day. The doors of the church are open. Let us stand.
Amen.
Amen. If you have never received Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, there's no better day than today.